Welcome to Performance Anxiety, a proud member of the Pantheon Podcast Network. We are lucky enough to have spent an evening with producer and chef Ted Niceley. Ted talks about issues flying, working with artists like Tommy Keene, Fugazi, Shudder To Think, Girls Against Boys, the Dead Milkmen, and so many more. And he also tells us about some lesser-known bands that you should know, like New Rising Suns, Future Kings of Spain, and Backbone Party. He's recorded in David Gilmour's mansion with Mickey Most's Gibson J200 that Donovan used to record Mellow Yellow and had Luther Vandross in the booth with him. And we haven't even mentioned his culinary career yet. So give him a follow on social media for great music and delicious food. And follow us at Performance ANX. Subscribe, rate, review, and check out the other great shows on the Pantheon Podcast Network. Now let's get right into Ted Niceley on Performance Anxiety.
Let's try and make it good before we begin. Okay, ready? All right. Hi, this is Ted Niceley, and I'm on Performance Anxiety with Mark Schiff. And did I pronounce last name right? Okay. And if you have the time, please check out. I'm a producer. I've produced three records with Fugazi. I've done three records with Girls Against Boys. I've done four records, actually, with Girls Against Boys, now that I think of it. And I did the Pony Express record by Shudder To Think. And there's some other ones, like The New Rising Suns, which you can hear on Bandcamp, and Backbone Party, which you can also hear on Bandcamp. So check them out. I've been to Dallas a few times, Austin once, I think. Yeah, for a, what is it called? South by Southwest.
Yeah.
In like the prime of the 90s, around 95, I guess, you know.
I don't remember anything about Texas. I was about 2.5 or 3 when we moved to New Jersey from there. So my dad PC.
But for me, it was kind of an iconic visit because I was a big Kennedy buff when I was a little kid, you know, he's killed. And
yeah,
so being around that Texas book depository place, I mean, I've always found, like, I produced a single by this band called the Grifters for Sub Pop.
Okay. Yeah.
And I went to Memphis and the lead singer took me to the site where King was assassinated, the hotel.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you can go right across from it, you know, and see the balcony, and they play gospel music, and the door is kind of open. It's
oh, wow.
Such a surreal vibe, man.
It is. Wow. I've been to Memphis a handful of times, and usually just passing through to travel somewhere for business or heading down to Alabama to see family or something. So I don't know Memphis all that well, but that's one place I would like to go because I've only gone through it and it always looks really cool, but I never had a chance to stop and spend any time there.
Go ahead.
I said never had a chance to stop any time. No, yeah, exactly.
No, man, I'm telling you, I had the most frightening plane trip to and back. I was on a propeller plane.
Oh boy.
Seated maybe about 50 or 60 and flying back out. I guess it was beginning of summer or something, and it might have even been summer. I was living in New York in Brooklyn.
Okay.
And I in Brooklyn Heights, and man, the plane flight back was just, oh my God, if I ever get out of this plane, I will never, ever get back into a propeller plane.
Oh, man.
You know, it's just, I mean, I walked in there and it was really hot, you know, and it just thunderstormed there.
Yeah.
But the sun was out and they turned on the air conditioning and all this vapor was pouring out of the air conditioning ports. And I thought, Jesus, man, I'm going to Buddy Holly it.
Oh, no.
You know?
Oh, God, man. See, I grew up, my grandfather was a pilot, and so I grew up flying all over the place in a plane that sat, you know, like 7 or 8 people. So we would fly. We would go, when we were living in New Jersey, we would get in his, he had a Cessna 310, and we would, it's dual engine, but it sat like, I don't know, I think there's 5, 6, 7 people, maybe, you know, comfortably. Mm-hmm. You could squeeze an eighth in there if you really had to. But I remember flying from New Jersey down to Marco Island, Florida, just in that thing.
Yikes.
Yeah, we'd that's one of the areas we would hit Memphis, and that'd be like where we stopped for the evening, and then get back in and fly the rest of the way the next day. And I loved it. And when I was like, I don't know, 10 or so, he called me up to the front, and my dad was usually the co-pilot, and he kicked my dad out, and he let me fly the plane once. It was awesome.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I love flying. You know, it doesn't really bug me. It's just sometimes the extra, you know, something happening, like... Oh, man, I've got some hilarious plane stories from the... man, from boarding and stuff, you know what I mean? Are we taping now?
Oh, yeah. We are definitely taping.
Oh, great. So. Oh, brilliant. do you want me to continue?
Absolutely. This whole show is just about great stories. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's why I was really attracted to it.
Awesome.
This is funny. We were out in Los Angeles making, I'm pretty sure we were making the Places That Are Gone video when we were on Geffen.
Oh, with Tommy Keene. Yeah.
Right. Listen to Me. We did the second video, Listen to Me.
Okay.
The man inside the plastic door shouting out your name. And who'd believe your selfish world is falling down again? All around you, little people.
And anyways, I was in February, and we were coming, we were getting ready to come back, and Tommy was going to stay there to do some post-production stuff.
Okay.
With the director, and so the drummer Doug Tall and the other the rhythm guitarist, second vocalist Billy Connolly, and I went to the airport. So, you know, we're waiting for the plane. It took forever to get on this plane, and it turned out that Doug Tull, the drummer, was very, very, he had a lot of anxiety about flying.
Okay.
And even taking like a lorazepam didn't really do the job, you know?
Right.
But so anyways, we had to wait about 3 hours to board the plane. And then we get on the plane, and as soon as we walk in, to our right is Mick Jagger with 2 bodyguards on either side of him.
Wow.
And we're kind of like, this is interesting.
Yeah.
so we go back and sit down, and then like 45 minutes later, I'm sorry, we're going to have to disembark the plane passengers, blah, blah, blah. We get off the plane, and Doug was like, man, I'm not getting back on that you know what plane. And I was a little nervous too, you know, but I wasn't totally freaked.
Okay.
And anyways, I said, okay, look, it's like this. If we, you know, this is over like an hour. And I said, look, if we go, they call us back to board. And if we go to the, we get on the plane and Jagger isn't on it, then I'm getting off. I'll call up Geff and we'll go back in. So we get on the plane, Jagger's gone.
Oh.
Because he was flying via Detroit, where there was a stopover at that point, and then to New York to be at Saturday Night Live, because Jerry Hall, his wife, was hosting the show.
Oh, on wow.
The Valentine's Day show. So,
oh man,
we get off the plane. My bass is already on the plane. The guitarist, Billy's guitar is on there, you know, blah blah blah, luggage,
right?
And anyways, we went back to the hotel, the same hotel, and hadn't called up Tommy. And so I open the door and Tommy's getting dressed to go to the thing, and he turns around and he just goes sheet white. It says, what the fuck are you doing here? Man, are you ghosts?
What?
Really? He was like, am I seeing a ghost?
Oh,
and
my.
I said, no. And I had to explain what had happened.
Oh, jeez.
He was like, I felt so bad, you know. Oh, I mean, I was like, God, I just scared the bejesus out of him. We did. And so then we the next day we get on the plane, we fly back. It's been horribly long, not a lot of sleep, and oh God, you know, the whole dealing with, you know, having recorded in Montserrat, and it's just been a month of craziness.
Oh geez.
And anyway, so we flew late again. I don't know why. Maybe it was the only plane we could. We get to D.C., where I was living then, at like 12:40, and they're unloading the plane. My luggage and everything comes off, but my bass in there.
Oh.
And oh no, the luggage didn't come off. And we didn't know if my bass was there. And then I think my bass came down the chute, but none of my clothes were there. I was really, really pissed off.
God.
And Doug, who was back on land and probably took two or three Lorazepam, he said, well, it's okay, man. Don't be there. And I said, I took my bass case and I threw it across the fucking, wherever it is, the welcome place. Oh. And I said, yeah, well, you were fucking scared to get on the goddamn plane if Jacko wasn't on it. You know, I want my fucking clothes. I'm tired of this shit.
Oh, man. You should have said Jagger and Bill
for
your
really
clothes.
Bad, and I felt really bad. You know, it was comical. It was one of the better things that ever happened. As far as, like, hijinks, you know.
So you should have sent Mick a bill for your clothes.
They brought him there really early the next morning. It was fine.
Oh,
I just, I'm the guy, at that point, I was really the kind of person who, you know, had reached their saturation level with mishaps.
Yeah. Well, some of the things that I want to find out about you, I want to know a lot more about how you got into this whole thing in the first place. When did music first really make an impact on you? Did you have a lot of music in the house growing up?
Not extraordinarily, but I my first musical memory is bouncing around on my brother Chris's bed, and he was probably 14. So that, I was probably six, something like that.
Okay.
He's 8 years older than me. And he was playing Blue Moon, probably the Marcel's version.
Okay, yeah.
And then, not long after that, my dad came. I remember being around the dinner table on a Friday night. My dad played Big Bad John by Jimmy Dean.
Oh, yeah.
And I guess he just bought some singles. Big Bad John, Jimmy Dean. The Ballad of El Paso by Marty Robbins.
Yeah. Oh, I love Marty Robbins.
And then Ring of Fire by Johnny Cash.
Oh, wow. That's good
and
stuff.
I've always been a sucker for that song.
Yeah.
You know, I loved it. Like, at some point, much, much later, you know, in probably 96, me and an engineer I was working with, Carl Glanville, he's British, and we were going to, I don't know, this is pretty crazy. I was like, why don't we do a split LP, and I'll do like Chance Meeting by Roxy Music and some other songs, definitely Ring of Fire, because we had one of these Kurzweil synthesizers.
Okay.
You know, it's almost like it's kind of a sampling keyboard.
Okay.
Had great mariachi horns.
And, oh, cool.
And then he was going to do some really wild ballad by some British, like, solo vocalist or whatever. But anyways, Johnny Cash, everything by Johnny Cash made a big impression on me. But, I mean, the pivotal point of getting involved in music was 1964, seeing the Beatles.
Okay.
On Ed Sullivan.
Right, right. The famous...
And... Yeah, and before then, you know, like, I guess the Beach Boys were happening, and, you know, certainly a lot of R&B stuff.
Okay.
And then my brother, Bruce, my middle brother, got a guitar. My father wouldn't give me a bass.
Yeah.
And because that's my instrument. But my brother, Bruce, kind of was very... I really want to be a guitarist. Now I want to be a bow hunter. Or I want to collect motorcycles or something. And so I just went over and picked up the guitar and started learning how to play. And a friend of his taught me more. He had some Mel Bay, you know, chord books.
Oh, yeah.
I had a pretty good ear. A very good ear, actually. And it just turned out that way. And I could just remember things. I could hear something and play it.
Okay.
And then I guess next stage was like doing a band for a talent show in elementary school. We were going to be called Danny and the Demons. I mean, we were going to be called Teddy and the Tornadoes, but I didn't like that. I didn't want to be named after it, so we changed it to our drummer's first name, Danny. Danny Gilmour, and it's called Danny and the Demons. It was just three guitars, a drum set, and we mainly played instrumentals, including one that we wrote called Moving On that was just a piece of every instrumental song we had already played. and then we did For Your Love by the Yardbirds, and I sang it.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome. Then I think a thing in talent show, and then there were some. I met a fellow named Jimmy Barnett who died last year, unfortunately.
Oh, wow!
And he was about I don't know, 8 years older than me or something, and he was really into recording. He'd already been in some semi-legendary DC bands. I wish I could remember the names of them. You know, I mean, the British Walkers were around then and everything.
Okay.
Had been around then more earlier in the 60s. I saw him play in a 60s band at my brother's school or maybe my junior high or something. I can't remember. Something like that. And
yeah.
And then, so he was really into recording. He's a great lead guitarist. And I had switched over to bass by then. I started out on guitar, you know. But okay, I kind of quickly realized I wasn't going to be the next Jimmy Page or something. and there was another really talented person named Andy Mitchell that wrote tremendous songs, had a Lawrence Audio electric piano, like the kind you see on the Iggy Bowie tours when, you know, Bowie's producing Iggy Pop.
Yeah.
And Jimmy recorded him. So anyways, we formed this band called Phoenix that played a lot of community centers and stuff, playing kind of a hybrid of Black Sabbath meets Grand Funk Railroad and other progressive stuff.
Oh, wow. You know,
King Crimson.
Oh, man.
No, I wasn't calling Grand Funk a progressive band. There were just certain things we tagged into, like the beginning of that wailing thing, guitar riff on the beginning of that song Paranoid by Grand Funk.
Okay.
It sounded like an air raid song.
Oh, okay.
We had a song called Minus the Universe that was very kind of sinister, and Jimmy copped that lick from Paranoid by Grand Funk. It was, like, hilarious. And then, I don't know, in 1971, I saw, or maybe it was, I was at some point in 70-71, I guess, I saw an ad in the Washington Star, which was kind of like the preeminent music news, the newspaper in D.C. that was delivered in the evening, but it had a lot of classified ads, and especially ads for like guitars, amps, and people to be in bands. And I answered this ad, and it happened to be by this, advertising for a bass player. And it just ended up to be this band I'd seen like 2 weeks before called the Sonny Boy Reed Organization.
Oh, wow.
And so I went down in the basement and I didn't know what to expect, really. I don't know if we had spoken that much on the phone besides how to get there. Right. And I was 17. Everyone else in the band was like 20, 21. They were all 4 years older than me.
Okay.
So anyways, it was the guys from the Sonny Boy Reed Organization. And, you know, I auditioned. I was kind of coming from bass-wise, like, I was playing with the Rolling Stones or the Jeff Beck Group, let's say, and I was playing bass like Felix Pappalardi from Mountain, kind of.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So, you know, they were nice enough to give me another audition, and I was already listening into the Stones and stuff like that, Baker's Banquet, all that, but I just kind of adapted, and we ended up being in this band, which, I don't know, maybe you've seen some pictures of us on my IG page, Niceley Music.
Yes.
So anyways, that led to quite a long time, but as far as being a kid, you know, I mean, I just listen to the radio all the time. It's one of my biggest influences, 60s radio. The way it was. I mean, because it is, when I got older and I kind of got into the British charts and everything, I feel like 60s radio is a lot like their radio was formatted before in the United States became a big deal of formats, you know, like,
okay,
here's going to be our classic rock radio station and our R&B station, urban, you know, so on and so forth. It was everything. It was like Strangers in the Night by Frank Sinatra, and it was a 19th Nervous Breakdown, or even weirder, you know, like I Had Too Much to Dream Tonight by the Electric Prunes, or something. It was all over the place, you know, the Seeds, or, you know, even the 13th Floor Elevators there for a minute, and Dean Martin.
Man.
And then, you know, of course you had, you know, Roy Orbison, Supremes, everything, you know, it was just, and then the Doors started creeping and all this, you know, psychedelic stuff that managed to have hits, and it's pretty informative, you know.
So you had a wide range of influences then.
Yeah. And that's just really continued where I worked in this kind of iconic D.C. area record store called Yesterday and Today with Skip Groff. And, you know, people from all over, really the world would come and shop there, especially for singles. And I got, you know, already was pretty tuned in. I read all the British music newspapers and stuff. And I read Rolling Stone. And I don't know, you know, I just got exposed to a tremendous amount of stuff.
So how did you start getting into the production side of things?
Well, I always remember Jimmy and recording us. And in the Raz, Jimmy actually recorded our demos in the lead singer Michael Reedy's house. And so I had a big interest in, you know, like, you know, he had a 4-track tape machine. He could do 8 or even more tracks through, you know, the sound-on-sound functions on the recorder. And, of course, you know, you lose quality every time you do that. But, you know, we could overdub. And then in the Raz, we did a lot of recording. And, you know, again, I mean, we started recording professionally, you know, like 16 track, 2-inch, 24 track, 2-inch studios with, you know, at least an MCI console or something like that. Yeah. One place had a Nave. And then I just kind of took the, I started, you know, there was a lot of time, downtime to kill in some of these sessions. And and I would read Recording Engineer and Producer magazine, and they would diagram studio setups every month, or you know, however many times they came out a year.
Right.
And, you know, I just was, because the drum sounds were really depressing a lot of times. and I had already, you know, kind of, you know, said, well, let's put the harmonizer on the snare drum on this song called Si Redu by the Raz. And, you know, during the middle eights or something like that, and the bridges, rather. And then I would read in these diagrams about how they were miking the drums. And, you know, they'd show the mic diagram from some girls or, you know, some other session. You know, this one particular producer, I remember Chris Kimsey, I think, who worked a lot with the Stones. You know, he was like using ambient mics, and I saw the measurements for, you know, like 9 feet up and 9 feet away. And I was like, okay, I'll try that. And I, you know, walk in the studio, how about we put some ambient mics back here? And, you know, they might not have been 9 feet up and 9 feet away, you know, but it was just an idea.
Yeah.
And so the drums all of a sudden would sound better. And after the Raz broke up, I was in a band called Nightman, where I came a little more front-wise in the production side of it.
Okay.
And that was definitely where I worked a lot on drums, because I had been working with a gentleman named Mark Greenhouse at Track Studios in Silver Spring, right outside of Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And Mark was kind of like a mentor, you know. He had assisted on some Linda Ronstadt sessions from Heart Like a Wheel, when I think she was in town with, like, doing some dates. And you know, they kind of gravitated towards that kind of thing.
Okay.
And so, you know, I kind of learned how to do vocals, record vocals. Now, I have to put one thing out here right away.
Okay.
I'm not an engineer.
Right. Okay.
I don't like engineering. I saw Mark get tied up at, you know, 12 o'clock at night with, like, one of the patches on the compressor isn't working.
Oh.
And then, you know, fighting with it for an hour or something. So I was like, nah, not for me. I can't do that. I, you know, that part of my brain isn't really that great. But
yeah, well, you got to know your strengths.
You know, at a certain point, you know, I've been playing in bands for so long and recording for so long. And then, you know, I played with Tommy from, you know, 19, you know, after the Raz broke up in 79. And then I was in this short-lived project with a couple of people from the Raz and a principal songwriter and singer named Mike Colburn. And we recorded a lot. And with Tommy, you know, we had worked with T-Bone Burnett and Don Dixon, besides just producing ourselves. But we did an album with T-Bone Burnett and Don Dixon that was never released. Places That Are Gone was called, well, at Track Recorders, after, you know, the Raz offshoots got, you know, done with, Tommy, who had gone to New York and played with Suzanne Fellini, who had that hit Making Love on the Phone.
Okay.
He was in her touring band.
Oh, okay.
And then he stuck around and was in a band with Kenny Aronson, who is a bass player. I'd already opened up for him the band he was in called Dust, that also had Marky Ramone in it, and the lead guy was Richie Wise.
Oh, wow.
And Tommy had been at that gig. He was like 13 or something. I was 17. Right? And I had met Kenny a couple times, various places, I guess. We all had. He had played, God, I want to say he was playing in the Johansson band, but no, he wasn't. I know I saw him like play with Derringer and all this. So anyways, Tommy was playing with all these people. And this band he was in called Pieces was being managed by the person that managed Blondie for quite a while. Peter Leeds.
Oh, okay.
I think Shep Gordon managed them later, the Alice Cooper manager or something. I'm not sure. But Peter Leeds was managing them. And anyways, he came back to Washington. And, you know, we had kind of kept in touch. And I like Tommy a lot. You know, he's a very talented guy. And then, you know, he said, I'm going to try my own group. I got some songs. Will you produce my demos?
Yeah.
And I was sure. And that just kind of started off that whole thing. And we did a more or less regionally released album called Strange Alliance.
Concrete sidewalks never took my feet down this way before. Ran down the pavement, you should have saved it evermore. Don't feel so sorry, we never tally.
And then we went into the and the thing we did with Tommy is that we immediately went on the road.
We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors.
We started playing New York, Philadelphia, all that stuff. It was like, don't get caught up in Washington. So, I mean, we demoed tons of stuff with Tommy and I co-producing at this studio called Hit and Run.
Okay.
And then I don't know, someone started shopping it. It was out there. I think maybe it was Seth Hurwitz who was managing us by then. And some kind of, it sounds kind of crass, a marketing firm, but you know, everyone was looking for new talent and,
yeah.
You know, records were starting to come out a lot. And they heard a couple of songs we had demoed that became the Places That Are Gone EP. We, you know, there were six pulled from all these Hit and Run sessions we had done.
Okay.
And so a small record label that was owned and worked by a record bar, which is was kind of like the Waxy Maxies of North Carolina, I think, formed a label called Dolphin, and they were looking for bands. And this woman, Pat Day, had heard our tape from side one, and she heard it and immediately took it to her people, and they wanted to work with us. So
awesome. We
did the Places That Are Gone EP, and it got 4 stars in Rolling Stone.
Wow.
It got a lot of acclaim everywhere. And we had kind of decided to take a very zen approach to looking for a record label, with which Raz, it was just always the thing.
Yeah.
And so that worked out really great, and we were going to do a full album, and we did that. You know, they wanted a name producer, and Don Dixon had produced some stuff already for the label, and I think he was maybe I had already worked with Guadalcanal Diary. I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I think so. I want to say he did by that time. I know he was working with Marty Jones. He had released some solo stuff. And, of course, they'd been in some seminal North Carolina bands or whatever that were on Dolphin, I think. He was producing stuff for them.
Yeah.
I was listening a lot to T-Bone Burnett, this album called Proof Through the Night, that a guy named Jeff Eyrick produced, who did the, later on went and did the Plimsolls for Geffen. And, you know, he did produce Million Miles Away and all that.
Okay.
By the Plimsolls. And then he also had produced an album by the Gun Club called Las Vegas Story that I was super attracted to.
Yeah.
Because it was the best Gun Club had ever sounded, but had all that kind of crazy energy, you know, with Kid Congo and all that,
yeah.
You know? And I was like, man, we gotta get this guy Jeff Eyrick. But at first, Dolphin was really like, let's get Marshall Crenshaw.
Oh,
which
wow.
I kind of, I didn't, you know, for me, I didn't love the idea.
Yeah.
Crenshaw was kind of regionally big in our area, and I'm sure he meant a lot in a lot of places, but. So T-Bone came up, and we went in the studio with him, and of course, we later went in the studio with Jeff Emmerich, who had engineered the Beatles after we got signed to Geffen. Tommy got signed to Geffen. And Tommy and I produced a lot of stuff ourselves in, you know, together on the Tommy Keene group. And then I had produced regional things when the Razz was kind of a big deal. I had produced this band called the Sleepy Boys. I did a really important single with them called Gotta Tell Me Why that I kind of ended up producing by, how would you term it? I went there with Skip Groff to the session.
Okay.
Who was, you know, really supposed to be producing it. And I, you know, somebody asked me, you know, you want to work on sounds? And I was like, sure. And then, you know, I said, okay, Skip. And he's like, no, keep on going. So we ended up, I just kind of ended up doing the session. And Skip, you know, executive produced. I kept on turning around. What do you think? Great.
Yes.
And, WHFS, WHFS, you know, which was the main station in Washington, D.C. area.
Yeah.
And then the Slickies asked me to do an album. I think they ended up calling it Here to Stay, which was the next one. It had the, I know it had the single The Brain That Refused to Die.
Yeah.
I was quite an undertaking because we did it at Track, and Track wasn't really a very cheap studio.
Okay.
And so, you know, I was getting stuff on the radio, and then Tommy's Strange Alliance EP, it had 8 songs. I mean, you know, it's basically an album.
Right.
They started playing the title cut, Strange Alliance, and then I think The Heart Is a Lonely Place to Hide was on a record of Skip's called Connected, which was kind of all the connections between the groups, and that recorded for his label.
Okay.
Or had records that were co-put out by his label. And I ended up, it was almost a vanity project between Skip producing stuff and me producing stuff. And, you know, a lot of that got played on the radio, and Places definitely got played. And, you know, the Geffen record got played. And also when I was playing with Tommy, we worked with Bob Clearmountain on a song for a movie that we were in called Run Now.
Okay.
The movie's called Out of Bounds. It has Anthony Michael Hall in it, Jennifer Wright from St. Elmo's Fire.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And then some guy playing the bad guy you've seen in a zillion movies. And it was directed by the guy who did all of Clint Eastwood's, or most of Clint Eastwood's post Dirty Harry movies, and like Tightrope and stuff like that. And,
yeah.
And this was going to be Anthony Michael Hall's first like serious role.
Okay.
And so we went out to Los Angeles and we're in the movie.
Oh, cool.
And so was Susie and the Banshees doing Cities and Dust.
Oh, wow.
And then John Kolodner, who was an R&R person, Tom Zutaut was, who had signed Guns N' Roses at Geffen.
Yeah, yeah.
He signed Dokken and Elektra. He signed Public Image at Elektra, too. Was very interested. And he got Tommy, you know, a song on there. And we had this song laying around called Run Now that we had done by ourselves.
Yeah.
We had had it produced by T-Bone and Don, and it just wasn't going anywhere. And then we walked in the studio with Clear Mountain. Here's a great story. I'm working it yesterday and today, right?
Right.
Tommy and I are both like extreme Clear Mountain fans.
Okay.
We loved the Bryan Adams Reckless album.
Run to You. Yeah.
I always thought the beginning sounded just like this Echo and the Bunnymen song.
Yes.
I think it was Rescue.
I know which one you're talking about.
And this was like in a minor thing.
I always thought it reminded me of that song by the Hollies.
Clear Mountain had done a lot of great stuff. So anyways, I was at the record store and I had heard something that I might get a call.
Okay.
From him, because I was kind of like the technical guy of the band or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyways, I was, you know, yesterday and today are split, and we're split into two stores. One was the main store where we had albums, CDs, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
The other side was the single side, which is exclusively 45s.
Oh, wow.
I mean, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth, probably.
Jeez.
You know, collector stuff all over the place. Right. I'm in the single side, and all of a sudden, somebody calls me on the phone. I guess there were two phones in there. I'm not sure. Maybe it had a hold. It had called waiting. And so someone said, "Ted, Bob Clearmountain's on the phone." And I said, "Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay." So I pick up the phone. I hear his very nice voice say, "Hi, Ted. This is Bob Clearmountain." And I said, "Yes, sure." And I could hear him kind of do, "No, it's really Bob Clearmountain." And I was like, "Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Please excuse me. We're kind of excited about coming in studio with you." So he explained, you know, he's like, "Yeah, I just want to touch bases with you before you come up here and, you know, lay out a couple, you just, you know, see how you are and get a couple ideas from you about the band." And, you know, he said, "One thing we're going to do is work with a click track, because it's not about, you know, keeping the drummer nailed down. It just makes it easier to edit between takes, etc."
Okay.
And I said, "Sure." And we have a lot of problems recording songs from the film with Jeff, because Jeff was very, very, he was a very nice guy, but there were some things going on that I think he didn't understand that really confounded him, like why our A&R guy was there the whole time.
Oh.
We were making a record, and he was, you know, I mean, I'm sorry, you know, Tom, I'm sure he meant well, but he was a pain in the ass. Yeah. He was very problematic all the way across the line. And Jeff was, I think he was like, he didn't really know what to, he wasn't a very conversational person.
Okay.
We did pre-production with him. He never said, "How about if Doug tries quarter notes on the kick drum, you know?"
Yeah.
Or, you know, "You break down your bass part a little bit," or something. And you know, so we just went in there and played. And then they tuned Doug's drums enormously weird.
Oh.
And we had the engineer from, who had worked a lot on, worked with Acid Camera, worked with Mark Knopfler, you know, all this stuff, you know. So I was like, why aren't they giving Doug so much of a problem over the drums, you know, the sound of them?
Yeah.
Because they had tuned his drum heads really low, like, so they were not really tight. And Doug was having a lot of trouble playing his drums tuned that low.
Oh, bad.
You know, I mean, like, the snare drum, he could almost, like, put his hand through the snare or something.
Gosh.
But, you know, people were really doing a lot of sampling and junk and certain sounds. And anyways, I didn't really run into the same kind of things. He wasn't really helpful in the vocals. And, you know, all stuff that I think everybody thought, hey, this is the guy that sat next to George Martin for years.
Right.
I mean, you know. It wasn't, none of us really wanted Jeff Emmerich to produce our album. It was their idea.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, Billy and all of us were Beatles fans at one point or another. You know, I mean, you're always a Beatles fan, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
If you like them, but Billy was very connected to him. But he had also produced Imperial Bedroom by Elvis Costello. He had done a, a soundtrack with Big Country by, you know, called Restless Natives, and a Scottish movie. And I thought, well, you know, if you work in Big Country, he's not going to fuck up the drums.
Yeah.
Which, you know, bad call.
Yeah.
And Aaron Monserrat, I'm not trying to dog it, but it wasn't a very interesting room to record in. You know what I mean? Like, there was this beautiful area where we ate dinner, like a veranda, and then this living room, like the lounge area, and Live Aid was going on during the first part of when we were recording there.
Oh, wow.
At Air Montserrat, and all these people kept on drawing by. Paul Young was there on the way back from Live Aid. You know, Live Aid was going on. So, you know, he came there. Midger was there the night we got there from Ultravox.
Oh, man.
You know, I mean, you know, it's just kind of a weird scene. But I saw this area and I was, you know, it certainly went off in my head a couple of times. Like, why aren't we recording drums in this room?
Yeah.
You know, later on, if I was in a band, or certainly if I'd ever done a record there, which I wouldn't have recommended for other reasons, I would have said, we're going to record the drums right here. Right here.
Yeah.
Because it would sound amazing. But when we worked with Bob, Clear Mountain, recording to a click was wonderful. Okay. He listened. We played the song through. He probably already listened to a demo, but he wanted to hear us play.
Yeah.
And just after the thing, he said, "Okay, in the intro here, break down the kick drum to this. Play the kick drum these kind of notes, and then on the bridge, let's cut down to halftime, and you know where the whole song was eighth note, all of a sudden a quarter note, I guess. You know, I mean, I'm kind of trying to talk in some kind of understandable thing. You know, all I know is he broke it all down.
Yeah,
and the song just kind of became a, that's what we needed.
Okay.
And between that and this thing, probably the most cool thing that the T-Bone Burnett Don Dixon crew did on the songs we were recording for the album on Dolphin, which also would have been called Songs from the Film. I found out later that was Tommy's working title for his first album. They took a drum fill that Doug did and put that on as an intro, and then took the chorus and flew in like a snare drum, just doing bah, da, da, boom, boom, you know, on the kick.
Okay.
And made the intro to it. It's a song called Back Again Try. And I was like, wow, man, that really, it sounded like the Hollies. It sounded like an intro for a Hollies song.
Oh, cool.
Like Carrie Ann or something like that, you know? And then with Bob, just in the couple of things he did with Clear Mountain, did with us, that I was like, wow. He really changed the song. He made it great. And so then when I started, you know, I just started hearing things like that. And, you know, sometimes you don't need to do stuff like that. Often you don't when you produce a band. But, you know, maybe 50% of the time, 30% of the time. You know, like certainly when I worked with Fugazi, I probably didn't suggest a lot of kick drum stuff. I don't know.
Yeah.
I know if someone was doing the same thing in every song, I probably would have said, you know, you're doing that in like this song. Let's think of something else here.
Right, right.
But, you know, in other bands I worked with, it would definitely be the full on, like, let's work on these.
You kind of had a mix in your style of producing of suggesting, depending on the band. I know some producers, like, you know, Steve Albini is notorious for just letting a band play and, oh, that's your sound. That's what you guys sound like, and that's it. But there's others that are more, I guess you could say, helpful, providing suggestions to the band and maybe some guidance.
I mean, well, it's strange. You know the story behind and on the Killtaker and me and Fugazi, right? And Steve?
I'm not sure. Feel free to tell me about it.
Well, I did the first Fugazi EP.
Yes.
The eponymous, I guess you call it.
Yes.
And then that was grafted onto 13 songs, which was the Red EP, let's call it, and then Margin Walker that they did with John Loder. Back from that, and they were kind of like, didn't dig the experience we had with Loder, you know. It wasn't John, it was just the way they had to do it, because John rented a really great studio called the Greenhouse, I think it was called.
Okay.
Where like a lot of, you know, like the Wonder stuff recorded there a lot.
Oh,
Julian Cope, I think, worked at Livingston. It was a very well-known studio anyways.
Right.
Pretty sure it was called the Greenhouse. And so Brennan, and it was at the end of this like 80-date European tour where they were staying in squats, and Brennan had been sick. So John was like, okay, well, we're going to go into this studio and record the drums. And then we're going to go into my studio, which I think had an overdub booth and a control room.
Okay.
And do the rest of it. And Fugazi is very much alive. They want to do it live to tape.
Yes.
And then some overdubs.
Yes.
So that's the way we had done the Red EP, and that's the way we always did it, because they're a very, very, very well-rehearsed band.
Yeah, for sure.
And, you know, not to the point of being like you know, stiff.
Stale.
Or anything.
Just, yeah,
you know, they want to know what they want to go in there and do what they do, and then whatever else happens is great.
Yeah.
But after Repeater, I kind of bowed out. I was like, you know, there were a couple of things I just decided I should kind of take it off for various things.
Right.
And they did. And we had been talking about doing what became Steady Die to Nothing. And then they did Steady Die to Nothing, producing it themselves, and it didn't go very well.
Right.
And so then, and we were all still friends, you know. I talked to Guy and Brendan, the drummer, all the time. And
yeah,
he's one of the principal songwriters and singers and guitarists. And he called me up and said, oh, well, we're going to record some songs. I got the recording LP. He said, we're going to Chicago to record with Steve Albini. And I was like, wow, that's great. This is right after Goat had come out by Jesus Lizard.
Yeah, okay.
Definitely a very big thing going on there.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, have a great time. And I was thinking, man, if this happens, really cool, it's gonna be great. Now, besides maybe some philosophical differences I have with Steve, I think he's done some really great stuff. And
oh, yeah,
even some stuff I don't particularly like the sound of, but I do like the artist, like, say, Rhythmy by PJ Harvey.
Okay, yeah.
You know, I thought Rhythmy was kind of like hard to hear the songs sometimes, but she really, the songs and her voice and everything really just made the best of the cacophony. I think that Steve kind of records everything the same way.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, it's really clam boom, but there's albums he did that didn't sound like that, like Surfer Rosa and the Breeders' first album when Tanya Donnelly was in there, you know.
Yeah.
Later went on to Belly, and yeah, I guess had been in probably Muses at the time, or maybe had just left. Anyways, they went in the studio. This is in the book 33 and a third book, The Making of In on the Kill Taker.
Oh, okay.
And they'd gone in the studio with Steve, and, you know, we kind of set him up. They really had a great hang, you know, making food and yeah, rapping and everything and recording. And I don't think the songs maybe were as fully developed, they only went in there in the intention of maybe recording three songs, but they were having such a good time, they just started laying down all this stuff.
Oh, wow.
And were very excited. And, you know, it's really similar to the way Tommy and I, and all of us, I guess, felt about songs from the film with Jeff Emmerich, because he did a rough mix one day. And, man, I'm telling you, the rough mixes of, like, four of those songs were amazing.
Oh, really?
It was like the Beatles, you know, that really cool kind of fuzzy, warm Beatles sound meets us. You know what I mean? It was just a tremendous sound. You know, they had all those Fairchild limiters and stuff, you know, those old tube limiters they were using. And these rough mixers were great. And then he sat down to mix the album, and it was just kind of, now I like it, but when we came home, we were very kind of like, eh. And we got William Whitman, who had worked with the Hooters and everything, to remix. And that's where I met John Agnello, by the way, who's been a friend since that session.
Oh, cool.
He was engineering for for William Whitman, who had done the Hooters, and they had just done The Outfield, I think, and that was beginning to come out. And Bill was doing mixes for, like, Loverboy. Everything that Clear Mountain wasn't mixing, Bill was. And John was assisting him.
Okay.
So I met John there. But anyways, back to the other thing, you know, they had recorded and they were very excited by, you know, this, the kind of, you know, it was new. But when they started listening to it on the way home from the session, and Steve started listening to it at home, I think everybody thought, oh, God, this is a mess.
Oh, geez.
And they let me, you know, they called me up and said, we want you to listen to some stuff. And I listened to it. And it was kind of like that, you know, when you record stuff with a lot of ambient mics in rooms and you use too much room sound, you can never really get a balance, because you want to hear the guitars more, the drums and the vocals get buried, and then you have to turn up the vocals. And if you want to record everything with ambience, natural ambience, it's very hard to control it if you don't have everything on separate mics or and I'm sure Steve does, because he did that stuff with Nirvana, and they did the two singles, and, you know, there's still some elements. Like, Steve uses a really cool mic, or he did, called the Calrex Soundfield microphone, that has four capsules in it, and through some kind of phasing stuff in this control box, you can control the acoustics in the room that you recorded in.
Oh, wow.
You have four separate mic leads going into the console.
Wow.
And the engineer I worked a lot with at one point, Eli Gianni, who later went on to Girls Against Boys, and we made three of their albums together. We did an album in France by this band called Noir Désir, and we used that Calrex Soundfield mic, but we used it for everything. I mean, we used it on the drums, and a few places you would say, I've heard that sound before.
Come on, please. I don't want to suffer. I found one of my socks under the telephone. I've never asked these bells to ring.
But the vocals, we would record it, and you could really work, like, some cool things with it. But we were doing pretty, at points, you know, that band's music was kind of both loud and soft, you know, not, you know, I mean, like, they had some soft songs, like, where the drums were brushes and junk.
Right.
And so we had that thing. But anyways, a lot of ambience, and they didn't like the way it sounded, Fugazi. And at first, you know, I mean, I listened to tapes. There were some of the recordings I liked quite a bit, but they definitely need the vocals redone and some stuff. And some songs just need to be done again, in my viewpoint of listening to it very fast.
Yeah.
But Steve doesn't like to be remixed and additional production.
Yeah.
And the band definitely thought they could do a lot better, which I wouldn't disagree with particularly. But, they definitely need to do the vocals. And anyways, I ended up redoing that. Help me get back to the place I was at. It tied into recording techniques. I just learned a lot, man. I watched people do this, and I watched the Clear Mountain session really informed me. I wasn't trying to make records like Bob. There were other engineers and producers like Steve Lillywhite I dug, Tommy and I dug, and he kind of revolutionized that room sound with the Peter Gabriel sound, Peter Gabriel song, Games Without Frontiers.
Yes.
And XTC, the Black Sea album, particularly.
Okay,
I mean, he did two of those things, but that song, Respectable Street, I mean, that's a totally insane sound. And I mastered some records at the studio he recorded that at called Townhouse in London. And I saw the Stone Room, which is where they recorded those drums, and like Phil Collins did In the Air Tonight and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Man, that room is like a big as a bedroom.
Oh, really?
I mean, it's dinky. It's dinky.
Wow.
I walked in there, and Jeff Beck had been recording some guitars there, and there was a room mic pointing straight up at the ceiling, and then another mic going in the just like going sideways in the room, and then I think they had a mic on the amp.
Oh my.
And that was it. And I was just like, man, I don't know how they're doing this in here, but it's crazy. Yeah. And there were certainly a lot of people that influenced what I was thinking of, but not being an engineer, I could only there were things that I could, I mean, I knew about aspects of acoustics and all that stuff. I just didn't want to mess around with wires and being in front of amps and stuff. Having been a bass player, I think a lot of producers are bass players or pianists and stuff like that. And I think being a bass player kind of helps you understand the relationship between the drum aspect and everything else. It's kind of the tying point.
Okay.
A lot of bass players end up as record producers.
That's a good, I didn't think about that. That's a good point.
I just read not that I read a lot of recording magazines anymore, but I do get tape up. And I read a great interview with Phil Thornley, who did the Thompson Twins with Alex Sakin.
And oh, wow.
He worked on some Cure stuff. He played bass in the Cure's on the Cure's live album, and maybe some of the Top, and I think he produced the Top.
Okay.
And I actually got to record in the studio where he came out of, called RAK, R-A-K Studios, and Lily White worked in there, and Mickey Most owned it, who produced all of
everything,
those records. Yeah, from the Animals to Susie Quattro to
Yardbirds,
man, everyone. And he was a really nice guy to boot. I used to have coffee with him in the morning on this one project I was working on.
Oh, wow.
And he was so nice, man.
Oh.
And I needed an acoustic guitar. I needed acoustic guitar for this song we were doing. This British band that was signed to Island called Carrie, the bass player from EMF, You're Unbelievable.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Was in it.
I remember.
And
that.
So I asked Mickey, I said, do you know where, who does rentals here? We need an acoustic. He said, hold on a minute, mate. He goes in the back room, comes out with this beautiful Gibson J200.
Ooh.
And says, here you go, use this. Donovan played Mellow Yellow on it.
Oh,
maybe you'll have a hit.
Gosh.
I was like, wow.
Whoa.
It was just so, so freaked out, man.
That'd be amazing to touch then, that guitar.
Yeah, and later on I was in another studio called Hook and Manor. It's got a really long, it's called Outside Studios, and Langer and Winstanley owned it.
Okay.
They had a studio in London called Westside, where they recorded, what is it called? They did a great Elvis Gusto album with the Madness Horns and stuff. I'm trying to remember the name of it.
Not real good with Elvis Costello stuff.
Yeah, anyways, Larry Winstanley bought David Gilmour's studio in this town near Oxfordshire called Hookin Manor. It was a mansion. And he had built a studio there. So they came in and built, I don't know if they added a control room, but it had this huge SSL with like 12 channels of Focusrite. And so it was a great thing. That's where I recorded, Eli and I did Noir Zir. And anyways, the Reading Festival that Nirvana played.
92.
Was during that album session.
Oh, wow.
And everyone was going to go to the Reading Festival. And Langer, Clive Langer and Alan Winstanley came in. Both of them had done albums that I loved. Alan Winstanley especially, you know, I mean, he'd done Lenny Lovitch, he had done, I can't remember. He just, the original Mirrors, which was an amazing record that nobody knows about. But I was a big fan.
I'm not familiar with that one either.
But Alan Winstanley, if you Wikipedia him or, you know, whatever, you'll see his discography. It's insane.
Okay. Clive Langer is really too.
Clive Langer, well, basically produced, they both produced everything by Madness.
Okay.
They did, at least Clive did. I don't know if Alan was working with him then. The Dexy's album with Come On Eileen.
Oh, Dexy Midnight Runners, yeah.
Right. And so, you know, I sat around for a good part, an afternoon, and then when they came back from the Reading Festival, which got rained, that's why I didn't go.
Oh, really?
You know, I said, nah, sorry, man, I've seen enough films and read enough stories in New Musical Express to know that Reading Festival is a fucking mudslide. I'm not going to get pneumonia while I'm making this record.
Yeah.
And so anyways, they come back, and meanwhile, I've been staying in this place, man, and it was so freaking scary.
Really?
This huge mansion, this walkway, this staircase up to where we were staying at in this, you know, in the mansion. We're like, it was like this. Do you remember this show called Thriller that Boris Karloff did?
No.
He was the host for.
No.
It was kind of like Night Gallery when Rod Serling did that after Twilight Zone.
Okay.
But anyways, there's this one episode about this mirror. And all I could think of walking up in those stairs was that show. It looked just like that episode. And man, I'm telling you, I've always been a scaredy cat. You know, I went to the movies when I was 5 or 6 with my brothers, and they took me to see this movie called The Village of the Damned.
Oh, right? Yeah.
Where these kids, these British kids, like, you know, were in this school. I don't know what happened to them, but their eyes would light up and people would just like blow their heads off and shit.
Yes.
I was so scared. I would look at, I turned my head around and watched the movie in the mirror.
My
brothers were like, fuck, I'm going to lose your ass when we're going home because you pissed us off so bad. Anyways, I was staying in this recording studio that was a mansion of David Gilmour's, and I was scared out of my mind, like I was 6 years old. I can't wait till they come home. Let me turn on the television and see if anything's going on.
Oh,
I wouldn't come out of this lounge. And then they got home and I was like, thank God, is my brain had a heart attack. I found out later that like David Gilmour's wife had this room they called the white room, this another part of the lounge exercise.
Oh my god, really?
And it was just so weird. I mean, you know, the pig from the Pink Floyd tours was in this shed behind the
place. My god.
you stay in these places in France, and you know, you record in these places in France and in England, and they're ancient.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have so many vibes, you know, I mean, for sure.